So this is lecture 8 and today we will discuss the concept of common mode feedback. So last time we had discussed when we started our lectures the problem of common mode feedback, but now I just wanted to recall it again so that we are all on same page. So as you can see that this is the telescopic cascode op amp. By now you must be aware of this because we have used this op amp so many times, but till now what we have done is we have just used it as an op amp without really discussing whether we are able to implement it in software or not. So today we will see what problems we have in implementing this in software, or if we design this in a form of chip, whether this circuit will work or not. So before discussing the issue that is there in this op amp, let me expand onto the full form of CMFB. It is actually common mode feedback. So what it means is you are applying some sort of feedback to the common mode signals which are present in the input excitation. As you know that the input excitation Vin can be decomposed into two forms, summed up into two different forms. One is the differential form plus the common mode form. So the differential form is still there and this feedback is not valid on this, but for the common mode signal, that is the signal which is common to both the inputs Vin1, this is the plus one and the minus one. So the signals which are common to these two signal excitations will have this feedback in action. So that's why the name common mode feedback. So let's discuss what is the problem. The problem is that we are trying to balance the current that is coming from this PMOS source with that of this current through the NMOS source. And if there is a slight mismatch in the currents sourced by this PMOS and NMOS, then either of these transistors, whether this pair or this pair, will go into triode and the other one will be in saturation. So what I mean to say is, if you have, for example, for simplicity I am drawing only two MOSFETs, one is PMOS, let us call it as M2, one is NMOS M1. So if you plot the ID versus VDS characteristics of this, what will that be? It is this, that is for NMOS we have ID versus VDS like this. So this is for NMOS, which is M1, and for PMOS it will be, since PMOS is a load line for this M1, it will be on this M1 itself. So it will be something like this. So it will also be a IV characteristics, that is the output characteristics for the PMOS, and it is for M2. So this is acting as the load line for this particular MOSFET M1. So what you are trying to do currently is you are trying to make M1 and M2 to operate in. Oh, so let me, just to avoid confusion, let me not keep it as M1, M2. Let me keep it as M3 and M5 just to match with these terms. Okay, so this is M3 and this is M5. So the important thing is we want these M3 and M5 to operate in as a current source. So in order to make a circuit to operate in current source, we have to operate in these regions, that is the flat regions of this IV characteristics. And the problem with this circuit is you want these two current sources to satisfy a particular Q point, and this particular point is very unstable. So it will either be this side or it will be this side. So the unstability of this point, that is the intersection of the IV characteristics at this point, is highly unstable. So what will happen is two situations will happen. In one situation, it can be the case that the load line intersects at this point, and in the second case it might happen that the load line intersects at this point. And we have just discussed that this case is very unlikely to happen, that is this one, where both these current sources will act as a current source. So it's a very unlikely event because of the unstability of this point, because it's the point of transition and it's very highly unstable. So any slight deviation of the voltage across these MOSFETs will tend to make this curve to move either this way or this way. So in either of these situations, for example, in this case here, M5 is in triode and M3 is in saturation. And in this case, M5 is in saturation and M3 is in triode. And in this case, both are in saturation, but the problem is it never happens. So you can see that either M5 or M3 is in triode. So either this will become in triode or this will be in triode. So that's the problem. And another way of thinking the same thing is that this is basically a current source and this is a PMOS current source and this is a NMOS current source. So let us say if these two currents try to balance each other, and you know that the IPMOS will not be equal to I of current of NMOS, and the reason for that is maybe because of the different temperature variations or mobility variations, this PMOS current source will never be equal to the NMOS current source. So what will happen is the difference of the current will flow through the intrinsic resistance, and this intrinsic resistance is the R out of M5 or M3. So it can be anything, because you are connecting this node, so this node has R out of M5 or R out of M3. So the difference of this current will flow through this resistance, and the voltage at this node will increase. So if this voltage increases, then what will happen? When this voltage increases, it might be the case that M5 will enter into triode, because the voltage here is increasing. And the other way around, if for example NMOS current source is greater than PMOS current source, it might be the case that it's random, that either of them can be greater. And in that situation, what will happen? In that situation, current will be going inside the node. And when the current is going inside the node, then what will happen? The negative voltage is generated across this resistance. The potential of this node will go down. And if the potential of this node will go down, then these transistors will come into triode. So in either of the situations, either M5, M7 will be in triode or M3 or M1 will be in triode. And when either of these will be in triode, the gain of the circuit will go down. Because we know that the operational amplifiers work when all the transistors are in saturation, then only you will be able to get the high gain. So what is the solution for this? How to avoid this situation is the common mode feedback that we will be looking in. So it's a circuitry that tries to avoid this situation and bring it back to the normal state where all the transistors will be in saturation. So this is the folded cascode version of the op amp, and you can see how the PMOS current source is fighting with the NMOS current source, and it's also a problem. And the problem is same as it was in the case of telescopic cascode op amps. That is, it's very highly unstable circuit, and we need to properly address this situation in order to make these amplifiers work. And sometimes these nodes which are here are also called as high impedance nodes. By saying high impedance node means the resistance which we see over at this node is very high, and normally we try to avoid these high impedance nodes by either connecting the diode connected transistors so that we can avoid these type of situations. Like you will connect this like this. So once you do that and you remove this, then it's a low impedance node now, because the resistance offered at this node is 1 by GM5, and that is in parallel with the high impedance of cascode resistance over here. So effectively you will get 1 by GM5. So then this impedance is now converted into low impedance node. This circuit also suffers from the problem of adjusting the PMOS current source with the NMOS current source. Now we have to come up with some solutions in order to address this type of problem where the voltage at these nodes fluctuates. It goes up or down, which makes these transistors go in triode or in saturation. So in order to address this, we use common mode feedback circuitry. And what is that? You can see tutorial representation of a common mode feedback circuit, and it gives you a high level understanding of how this operation works. So what we do is we actually sample the outputs, that is here these two outputs. Normally we call them as Vout1 and this has Vout2. So what we do is we sample these outputs out, and then we pass it through the common mode level sense circuit, which we will define how it looks like. And once we define this common mode level sense circuit, which will actually sense the common mode excitations here in these two parts, then it will be fed to the amplifier here, which actually compares the output of this common mode level sense circuit with VREF, that is the reference voltage. Typically it is taken as VDD by 2. So it compares the output generated by common mode level circuit with this VDD by 2 and makes the corrective actions by generating the voltage from its output terminal which controls this current source. So what is happening here? There is a feedback happening over here. So this is some sort of feedback happening. So whatever excitations we are getting over here are converted into a feedback action which is over here, which will change this current source, which in turn will reduce this excitations or the variations to bring it back to the normal level. So this feedback operation is basically called as the common mode feedback loop. So what we are doing is we are actually trying to suppress these variations which come on Vout due to common mode using common mode level circuitry and this operational amplifier. So this can be an operational amplifier or any other typical amplifier which has very high gain. So let us discuss each of these individual blocks, that is this one, and see how we can incorporate these blocks into the differential amplifier so that we can avoid the situation of common mode disturbance which arises due to the inability of the PMOS current source to become equal to that of NMOS current source. So by using this feedback loop we will make them equal to each other. So let us see how we can do that. Just to recall, maybe you are feeling confused that why this situation is coming, where this mismatch is happening and why it's not stable here and why it is getting stable at this point or this point. The situation is that this instability of these two current sources to become equal to each other arises due to the fact that these voltages, that is the voltages here, these VB3, VB2, VB1, they have some fluctuation in their supply lines. So these voltages are actually coming from some external circuits. So these they will definitely have some fluctuation due to noise, because these fluctuations are applied at the gate terminal of these MOSFETs. So it will definitely incur some deviation in the drain current source of M5 and drain current source of M3. So because of these deviations in the drain current source of M5 and M3, it is very difficult to make them equal to each other. And because of that, it either stabilizes to this case or to this case. So I have given you two reasons of why we need common mode feedback. One is this pictorial understanding. So this is the second way of understanding it. So now let us discuss the different type of common mode level sense circuit along with the amplifiers in our next slide. So this circuit is basically the telescopic operational amplifier, and you can see that we are actually using two resistors R1 and R2 to tap the voltages, which are the output voltages Vout1 and Vout2 over here. And the tapping is done by taking the central point of these two resistors and taking that node out, and we are calling it as VoutCM. So if you apply the nodal analysis at this point, then what you will get? You will get VoutCM 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2 minus Vout1 over R1 minus Vout2 over R2 equal to 0. So what is the value of VoutCM? The value of VoutCM is R1 Vout2 plus R2 Vout1, this is Vout1 here, divided by R1 plus R2. So if you solve this equation, what you will get is this. And if you assume that R1 is equal to R2, then what will be the value of VoutCM? The value of VoutCM will be Vout1 plus Vout2 divided by 2. So what you are doing here? You are actually taking the average of the two outputs, which are the outputs here, that is the Vout1 and Vout2, and we are calling it as VoutCM. So one thing you observe here, if you apply a differential input to the operational amplifier, then these Vout1 and Vout2 will change differentially. So as a result of which, the fluctuation in the VoutCM will be 0. Whereas if you apply common mode signal to the input of the differential amplifiers, then what will happen? Then the Vout1 and Vout2 will change in the same direction, and as a result of which you will get the value VoutCM, which is the average of these two outputs. So basically this topology, that is the connecting of R1 and R2 to the outputs of Vout1 and Vout2, are actually is used to sense the common mode signal which is present in the input of the differential amplifier. So this Vout CM which we are tapping it out is actually, if you see this circuit, is basically the output of this common mode level sense circuit. So this common mode level sense circuit is the two resistors which we are applying at the output of the differential amplifier, which is here. So this is very simple topology as far as common mode level sense circuit is concerned, but it has few drawbacks. So what are the drawbacks? The drawbacks are that if you see the output resistance from this side and if you see the output resistance from this side, it will be what? It will be, so let us say this one is Rn and this is Rp. So Rn is basically the cascaded output resistance of this part and Rp will be the cascaded output of the PMOS part. And you know that what is the cascode resistances of Rn and Rp are, and if you calculate the effective resistance, what will that be? It will be Rn parallel Rp divided by 2, and this resistance is large and we want this node to be not affected by this R1 and R2. In order to avoid loading of R1 and R2 onto this node, what is the constraint? The constraint is that R1 has to be much bigger than that of the R effective resistance at this node, which is the output node here. And the same goes with this node also. So that in that case also the constraint R2 will also be much greater than that of the R effective resistance. And because of this, the resistance values are very high. And you know that it's very difficult to lay out these resistance on the VLSI chip. And because of that, it sometimes is not advisable to use these R1 and R2 resistance directly. So that is one of the drawbacks of this circuitry. So let us see how we can use this R1 and R2 in the operational amplifier which is given over here. So one thing to note over here is that what we are doing is we are using this and this as an extra MOSFETs in between the output node, which is the Vout1, and the resistance R1 and R2. So you can see there is no direct contact between this node and this node, but it is connected through this MOSFET M8, and this M8 is basically the source follower, and you know that the source followers are acting as buffers. Why it is acting as buffers? Because it has the input resistance infinite and it provides low impedance at the output of this transistor M8. So it acts as a buffer so that the resistance R1 should not able to load the output voltage Vout2. Similarly, the resistance R2 should not load the output voltage Vout1. So the M7 is acting as a buffer in between that. So this is the additional MOSFET that we are using to avoid this problem of loading, which is discussed over here. So by inserting M7 and M8, what we are thinking is that it is helping us in avoiding the loadings that is created by R1 and R2 onto Vout1 and Vout2 respectively. But there is a inherent disadvantage of using this M7 and M8 as a source follower. What is the disadvantage? So earlier, if you see here, earlier if you wanted to calculate the Vout minimum for this node, what was that? Vout minimum is, or in this case, the Vout minimum is 2 VDSAT, right? How about this? So as you can see that there are two paths to these nodes to calculate the Vout minimum. One is this path, and what is the second path? The second path is through this path. So let us calculate through both of these paths. So let me call it as A and B. So the path B has Vout minimum as VDSAT of M3 plus VDSAT of M5. So if we assume that both of them are equal, so it's 2 VDSAT. How about from this path? It is Vout minimum equal to VGS of M7 plus VDSAT of I1. So in order to compare this with this, let me subtract 1 VTH from this. So let me subtract 1 VTH and add VTH. So it will not affect the equation. So this, you know, is VDSAT. This is also VDSAT. So it's 2 VDSAT plus VTH 7. So you can see that by incorporating these source followers, which are M8 and M7, the minimum requirement, that is the minimum swing constraint, is increased by VTH, and this is not desirable. So this is actually the problem. So we have to come up with some different topologies which will avoid these loadings, along with reducing this 2VD set plus VTS to 2VD set itself. So this is the first problem. And the second important problem with this circuitry is that this I1 is basically the sum of these two currents, which is IDM7 plus the current which is coming from here. And what is this current that is coming from here? The current that is coming from this side is basically the potential difference between this and this divided by the resistance, which is R1 plus R2. So what is the potential at this point? The potential at this point is V out 2 minus VGS M8. And what is the potential at this point? The potential at this point is V out 1 minus VGS M7. So the difference of these two potentials will be what? It will be V out 2 minus V out 1 plus VGS M7 minus VGS M8. So this is the difference of the potential divided by the total resistance, which is R1 plus R2, will be the current IX, let us say. So this is IX. So this is also flowing in this direction. So the problem is that I1 has to be large enough. It has to be large enough to incorporate both IX plus ID of M7. And if this situation doesn't happen, that is, this constraint doesn't happen, then what will happen is IDM7 will shut down. That this MOSFET will shut down. And if this MOSFET shuts down, then the whole operation of this amplifier will shut down. And the results will not be accurate. And you can see here that if the VGS of M7 and VGS of M8 are equal or made equal by these currents I1 and I2, if we make these I1 and I2 equal, then we can make VGS M7 equal to VGS of M8, and then this will cancel with this. So IX is basically V out 2 minus V out 1 divided by R1 plus R2. So the important point here is that I1 has to be large enough to incorporate both these currents to flow properly. If it is not, then M7 will cut off. And the reason why M7 will cut off is that this potential will rise when I1 is less than the prescribed limit of I1, which is, let us say, prescribed, which we are calling as I1 allowed. So you know that if you are sucking down the current from this node less as compared to what is allowed, then this potential will rise. If this potential rises and this is constant or nearly constant, then the VGS of M7 will reduce. If the VGS of M7 will reduce, then M7 will move towards cutoff, and the whole operation of this amplifier will get disturbed. And one thing to note here is, as I was discussing also, that this is a differential amplifier, but as you can see here, there is no differential input. So you can so what is this exactly? This is basically a part of the folded cascode amplifier. So basically this has to be taken out, this node, and this node has to be taken out and are then connected to the folded cascode input differential amplifier. So it will be input to the differential amplifiers present in the folded cascode version. So this is basically the branch of that folded cascode amplifier. So here in this circuit, we have discussed the common mode sensing circuitry implemented using R1 and R2, and we are tapping Vout CM out of it. And in the next circuit, what we will discuss is how to implement R1 and R2 using the MOSFETs, because as you know that R1 and R2 are difficult to lay out onto the chip. So it is necessary that we have to implement this through MOSFETs itself. And once that is done, then we will see how to use this Vout CM as the feedback to adjust the voltages. And basically what we will discuss now is this part of the circuit. And we will see how this CMFB output, which is the common mode output, which is Vout CM, will be used as an input to this amplifier, and how this output will help us to regulate this differential amplifier. So now this circuit shows the actual implementation of these resistances, as we have discussed just right now, that how to implement these resistances R1 and R2. So these resistances are implemented using M7 and M8. And the way it is implemented is that we are actually making M7 and M8 to operate in triode. So if you recall that when you operate a transistor in a triode, then it behaves like a resistor. and the value of that resistor is 1 upon mu n cox w by l times the VGS minus VTH across that transistor. So this is basically the resistance that is offered when the transistors are operated in triode. So here M7 and M8 are actually mimicking the resistance R1 and R2. So we are implementing R1 and R2 using M7 and M8, which are in triode region. And this is the point P, which is the tapping point, which we are calling as Vout CM. So this is the common mode output, which is taken from the two outputs, Vout1 and Vout2. So basically averaging of these two are done at this point P. So now what happens is, if you want to calculate the total resistance across the point P and ground, if you want to see the total resistance, then you have two resistances in parallel. So this is the resistance R7, this is the resistance R8, which is in parallel. So effective resistance between the point P and ground will be R7 parallel R8. And each of these resistances are defined using this expression. So when you calculate this expression, then what you will get is, you will get mu n cox w by l times V out 1 plus V out 2 minus 2 VTH. So this is the effective parallel resistance of of MOSFET M7 and M8, effective parallel resistance operating in triode basically. So if you look at this equation closely, what you will see is that the resistance is inversely proportional to the average of the two voltages. So this resistance is basically sensitive to the variation of the common mode voltage. That is, when you apply a common mode input, this Vout1 will, Vout2 will either move up or will move down synchronously with the common mode inputs, but it is not effective in terms of the differential inputs. Like when you will apply differential inputs, then Vout1 may increase up and Vout2 will go down. So as a result of which, the effective summation will be nullified. So the resistance will not be operated during the differential mode signaling, but it is operative during the common mode signaling. So that is good. So but basically what we are doing is, we are actually making this R tunable to the common mode input voltage and not to the differential mode input voltage. So after discussing this, let's discuss the output minimum voltage required at this node. As you can see that there are again two paths to it. One is this one and one is this one. So this one, we have already discussed that from this path the Vout min is 2 VD set, and from this path the minimum Vout one is VGS of 7,8. So roughly, if we because VG 7,8, that is VGS of 7,8 has to be greater than VTH, that is the minimum bound on VGS for M7 and M8. So if that is the case, and we know that Vout minimum is dominated by VG 7 or VG 8, then we can write that Vout minimum is at least greater than VTH of 7,8. And the reason for writing it as VTH of 7,8 is that VGS has to be greater than VTH to either be in saturation or in triode. That is the must condition. So this has to be satisfied in either of the conditions, whether M7 is in triode or in saturation. So based on that, what we are saying is at least Vout minimum has to be equal to the threshold of 7,8. So the problem here is that it might happen that our output voltage, that is the Vout1, drops to VTH 7,8. That is, the signal at this Vout1, if it is a sinusoidal excitation, it might happen that it drops to VTH 7,8. So if that is the case, and please note here we are discussing the differential mode signaling, not the common mode signaling. So if that is the case, when Vout1 is near to VT 7,8, then the voltage across the M7 will be VTH 7,8. Whereas in the differential mode signaling, the corresponding Vout will also rise by VTH 7,8. So this potential will rise as this potential is going down in the differential mode case. So the problem is that it might be the case that M8 will enter into saturation. And what is the reason for M8 to be in saturation? For the triode condition, we have VG minus VD greater than VTH of 8, right? So this is VG8 and VD8. So in triode we have this condition, but the problem is, so I'm sorry, there is a slight mistake that M8 is not in saturation, M7 will come in saturation. First of all, let us discuss why M8 will be in triode. So this is the condition for triode for M8. So VG8 is still getting bigger and bigger, whereas the drain potential is somewhere in between or it is fluctuating very less. So this condition is always satisfied in case of M8. So M8 will always be in saturation, whereas M7, which is in triode right now. So for the triode condition, we know that VG of M7 minus VD of 7 has to be greater than VTH of 7. But because the voltage at the gate is dropped down to VTH, then it might be the case that this inequality will not be satisfied anymore. So because of that, it might happen that it becomes less than VTH of 7. So if that is the case, then M7 will enter into saturation. So if M7 enters into saturation and M8 is in triode, then the effective resistance that we were discussing here will not be valid at all. So now the R7 will be of saturation resistance and R8 has to be of triode resistance. So there is an imbalance in the two resistances. If there is an imbalance between the two resistances, this resistance dependent on the averaging of V out 1 and V out 2 will go. So it will not be there. And the whole concept of detecting the common mode voltages out of V out 1 and V out 2 using these M7 and M8 will fail. And the reason for that is that R7 enters into the saturation mode and the resistance will no longer be valid as this one. So this has to be taken care of so that this type of situation should not occur. So a practical implementation of this is to attach this node P to some point into because this P right now is hanging out. So we have to attach this P somewhere in order to apply some feedback measure, because this P point is equivalent to the P that is coming from common mode level sense circuitry. So this is actually P. So this P has to be fed back to this amplifier so that we can adjust the currents and the fluctuations. So for this, what we are doing is the next circuitry is implementing it. So now you can see here what we are doing is we are placing this circuit at the bottom of this. So now you can see here we have this P. So let us see what kind of feedback measure, what kind of feedback this P is offering to us. So let us say by some means, if this voltage goes up, this will also go up, right? Because we are discussing the common mode feedback circuitry, and common mode feedback actually comes in action when the common mode input signal is applied to the input of the differential amplifiers. So if this goes up, this point goes up, right? If this goes up due to the common source amplifier M7, the drain potential will go down. So if this goes down, the source of M5 goes down and the potential at the gate is fixed, which is VB, then what will happen? So it's a common gate topology. This is a common gate topology because the gate of this MOSFET M5 is grounded and you are applying excitations at the source of M5. So if this goes down, then this potential also will go down. And how about this? This is also again a common gate topology because this potential at the gate is constant. So when the signal excitation at the source of this particular transistor, let us say M8, goes down, then this potential will go down. So now you can see whatever increase you had made at the VOUT1 is coming through the feedback action as going down. So the potential at this point will remain constant due to the feedback loop that is happening over here. And same is with this root also. So now let's derive the relation between the currents and the voltages. As you can see, since this circuit is operated in common mode, so what we can do is we can actually club these M9 and M10 together. And if we assume that the current through the drain of M9 is ID, then if you club these M9 and M10 together to form a single transistor, that is M9 plus M10, because it's a common mode voltage excitation, so we can club these two transistors together to form one single transistor. So if that happens, then the total current that will flow through the composite transistor will be 2ID, and then it goes down, and again we have this clubbing of these two transistors, which is here, and then again we will have these two transistors clubbed together. So it will be like, you know, if you call this as for example MX and MY, so it will be MX plus MY, and if you call this as MP and MP2, then you can call it as MP plus MP2. So you are clubbing these two transistors together with their gates attached, and then you have M5 and M6. So here also you will have M5 plus M6. So the same current, that is 2ID, is flowing through this M5 and M6 together, and it is going through the equivalent resistance between the M7 and M8. That is the summation resistance of M7 and M8. Total resistance of the composite transistor M7 plus M8, and we have seen that that is equivalent to, that is the effective resistance is equivalent to mu n COX W by L of 7 or 8 times V out 1 plus V out 2 minus VTH of 7 or 8, 2 times of it. So this is the effective resistance offered by this M7 and M8 composite transistor. And this effective resistance, what voltage it generates here? The voltage it generates here is I into R. That is, VP is I into R, and I is basically 2ID times R effective. So this potential VP is basically if equal to 2 times ID times this effective resistance. So this is VP now, and this VP is also equivalent to VB minus VGS of M5, because you are at this point VB, and in order to get VP, how will you go about it? You will go by subtracting VGS M5 or M6 from VB. So once you equate these two terms together, what you will get? You will get V out 1 plus V out 2 equal to 2ID over mu n COX W by L times of 7,8 times 1 by VB minus VGS 5 plus 2VTH. So what things we can conclude from here? The important thing that we conclude from here is that the output common mode voltage is sensitive to the device parameters here, which is not right. We want this output common mode voltage not to be sensitive onto the device parameters. That is very important. Because of this sensitivity, it can happen that the common mode voltage will also fluctuate. So we do not want our output common mode voltage to be the function of these device parameters. Secondly, as we have also discussed last time, when this point P was grounded, at that time the output voltage swing was 2VDSAT, but now it's not the case. Now it is 2VDSAT plus VP, that is the voltage generated at this point to ground. So this is also added additionally to the Vout min. So this VP is additionally added to V2VDSAT to create a increase in the Vout min constraint present at this node. So that is the second problem. And the third problem is, if we want to minimize this addition, that is the VP factor, so what we can do is we can increase the width of these M7 and M8. So if you increase the width of these M7 and M8, what will happen? If you, as you know, that the resistance of the triode is inversely proportional to the W by L, as you can see here. So it is inversely proportional to W by L. So if you increase the width of the transistor, the triode resistance will go down. So if triode resistance goes down, then the potential generated at VP, which is 2 times ID times R. So as R goes down, VP also goes down. So this potential VP will again goes down. And then the Vout min constraint will become more better as it is coming close to 2VDSAT. But in order to make that possible, the width of the transistors M7 and M8 has to be made large. If the width of these transistors are made large, then what will happen? It will introduce substantial capacitance at the output node. So you have to because you see the output that is here is directly connected to the gate of these MOSFETs. So the capacitance which is offered at the gate of these MOSFETs, that is CGS M7, the value of these capacitance will go up because the width of these transistors are made high. So that may create problems during the charging and the discharging of the capacitances, and it will slow down the circuit. So these are the three different problems that I have discussed with this circuitry. So in order to avoid this, what people have done is they will move this part to the input to the input of the folded cascode amplifier, so that this point P still remains at ground. So let us see how they have done it to improve this topology. So the problem that we have just discussed, that is the constraint on the output minimum, which is 2VDSAT plus VP, and this plus VP is there, that is the main problem here, because it is increasing the minimum value of the output voltage by plus VP. So how to avoid this? This is avoided by moving this section as discussed to some other part, that is the to the input differential pair of the folded cascode. So this circuitry shows you that, and you can see how this part, which is this part, right? Earlier this part was here, because you know, we had connected this and then we used these two NMOS devices as in triode, and this Vout1 and Vout2 were connected here. This was the earlier situation, and how we have moved this block to this side. So now the important thing is, let us check how the feedback is operating here. And it has been observed that the Vout CM is sensitive to VB, that is the VB potential here. Let us see how it is sensitive to VB. So for example, so let us assume there is a fluctuation in the VB potential and it goes up. So if this goes up, the current in ID M9 will increase. So if that increases, these currents will also increase, because the drain current of M9 is summation of I1 and I2. So if ID M9 increases because of the increase in the VB potential, then the I1 and I2 will also increase. If the I1 and I2 increases, then what will happen? Then this potential at this node will go down, because you are sucking out the currents from these nodes. So if this potential goes down, due to the common gate topology of M5, this potential also goes down. If this potential goes down, then it is directly connected to the gate of M8, so this potential will also go down. So if this potential goes down, due to the common source topology, this potential will go up. So if this potential goes up now, then what will happen? Effective VGS of M9 will reduce, because earlier what was happening is, in case of M9, the source potential was at fixed node and VG increased. So if that is the case, then the VGS of M9 increased, and so the drain current increased. But now what happened, due to the feedback action that is happening through this path, the feedback action that is happening through this path results in increase in VS. So if this VS also increases, earlier it was constant, so the effective VGS comes down. So if the effective VGS of M9 comes down, then the drain current will reduce. So if this reduces, so earlier the drain current was increased, but now it is reduced, so it counterbalance everything. So if this reduces, this quantity will also reduce. If this reduces, this potential will go up, and if this potential goes up, due to the common gate topology of M5, this potential will go up. So you can see there is a counterbalance of the decrease in the output voltage Vout1 happening due to the feedback loop that is present due to the CMFB action. So this is nullified. And you know that, so since we are dealing with common mode excitations, so what we normally do is, we will actually simplify this circuit in terms of the common mode excitation input. So for the common mode excitation, what we do is, we will use M3 plus M4 here and M5 plus M6 this side, and this node and this node are again joined together and is formed as one. And then for simplicity, I am not joining these two together, just for easy understanding, which you will come to know in a second. So this is M12, this is M10, this is M13, this is M11. So here I am claiming that this point is Vout CM, which is Vout1 plus Vout2 divided by 2. So how this is possible, that when you are joining these two points together, that is the Vout1 and Vout2, it is giving you this value. So in order to understand that, let me explain it with another example. So let us say you have one voltage V plus here and one resistance R this side, and V minus here and one resistance R this side. And for each of these two circuits, we are assuming the same current. So what will be the value of V plus? V plus is I into R. What will be the value of V minus? Is again I into R. So if I want to calculate the average of these two, that is the plus and the minus. What will that be? If I join them together, then it is V plus V minus equal to 2IR. So I am adding this and this together to form this equation. So, and this V plus V minus divided by 2 equal to IR. So this we know already. This we are saying as V out Cm can be written. So there is no problem in that, right? And if suppose I join these two nodes together, this one and this one, then what will happen? So when we join these two nodes together, let us say this node is Vx, then the effective resistance is reduced by half or not, because the two resistance will come in parallel. And if suppose by any means this current becomes twice the current which was flowing individually in this branch and this branch, let us say for the time being it increases to twice the current, then what will be the value of Vx? The value of Vx will be R by 2 times 2i, which is I into R. So this Vx is I into R, and this is also I into R. So that means Vx, when you join these two nodes together, that is the V plus and V minus, then the relation between the Vx and this one, that is the V plus and the V minus, will be this. Keeping this in mind, if we replace Vx with V out Cm, and V plus with V out 1, and V minus with V out 2, you will get this phenomena which we are discussing here. So here you have these two resistance R1 and R2, right? So they are in parallel, and what I was telling here is that you have this 2i current coming, and this 2i times current is coming because you are actually adding these two transistors M3 and M4 together, which increases the width of these two transistors as 2W. So once you have twice the W, the amount of current that flows into this device becomes twice. So this situation is same as we had discussed here. So that's why when these two nodes are joined together to form Vx, then the value of this node Vx is V out Cm. So that is what I am saying, that here we have V out Cm as V out 1 plus V out 2 by 2. So this node will become V out Cm. So this is the simplification of this circuit under the common mode excitation levels. So if some question comes in which we are asking you about the gain when the signal is excited by common mode excitation, then you can reduce this circuit into this form with this point written as this, and then you can do further analysis. Okay, so this is basically one of the topologies where the feedback action, that is the operational amplifier that we were discussing in the very first slide, because you know we are taking the two resistance like this, and then we are tapping this point and applying it back to the operational amplifier which we were discussing in the very beginning of this session. So this operational amplifier role is played by this M7 and M8 itself, and they are playing the role of triode transistors also. So this finishes off with the concept of common mode feedback, and in the next lecture we will discuss some other advanced topics.